Hello, everyone, and welcome to Mr. This is Asia, and here is Bangladesh. Now let's get the gist of it, shall we? Someone once said Egypt was the gift of the Nile. Well, Bangladesh is the gift of the Ganges, and the Brahmaputra, and the Shurma, and the Bongshi, and the Dakatya, and the Jaldaka, and the Koputar, and the Meghna, and so much more. You see, most of the country sits on the convergent fertile delta of these rivers as they flow from the Himalayas into the sea. In short, the land is good for farming, and agriculture has been the focus of this land for over 3,000 years, when the thick jungle was hacked away to make room for the human being. People had lived in the land long before, but were yet to tame it and truly harness the potential of the lush alluvial soil. So settlements of rice growers arose and formed a major economic background for the kingdoms that later stepped onto the scene. These kingdoms, well, not much is known about them outside some semi-mythical mentions in the Sanskrit epics, the Mahabharata and the Ramayana. From the 3rd century BC, Buddhism was embedded in Bengal, thanks to the influence of Mauryan India. Then Hinduism made a comeback via the Gupta kings. Then Buddhism made a comeback with the Pal Empire. This here was one of their monasteries. And here is another. The religion was effectively spread further east by the philosopher Atisha. Then Hinduism made a comeback when the Shen dynasty took over. Here's one of their temples. After the Dev dynasty, Buddhism did not make a comeback. Instead, it was pretty much crushed by the invading Muslims of the Delhi Sultanate. East Bengal incrementally came under Muslim control, and bit by bit the populace followed Islam. Muslim rule continued under the Mughal Empire, though many Bengalis didn't want this, so the Mughals forced them to want it. They got control in 1612 after 40 years of bloody war, and the Bengal region would boost Mughal wealth exponentially through taxes and plentiful exports. As trade expanded, so did demand, and more forest was cleared away to make room for farms. Some grew rich and went about in silk and jewels, but most were poor workers in loincloths living on rice and a few lentils. As Mughal power declined, along came the British, whose East India Company, after winning the Battle of Plassey, went on to conquer all South Asia, aided by the wealth supplied by Bengal. Britain had big plans for Bengal, aiming to really increase production. This came to be, but first their administrative experiments yielded a huge disaster in the Great Bengal Famine. Occurring at a time of drought and floods, with rulers still demanding taxes, well, 10 million people died of starvation. Though ruthless in economics, British rule brought benefits too, not least in health. The Bengali population went way up thanks to improved hygiene, hospitals, and medicine. Technological advances also made things easier, and the army and police became better organized. Hard times hit again in World War II, when the Japanese gobbled up British Hong Kong, Singapore, and Burma. 300,000 refugees arrived in Bengal. Britain, on the brink of fleeing, destroyed 60,000 Bengali boats as a precaution against Japanese invasion. This destroyed the livelihood of innumerable fishermen and river traders. Meanwhile, the Japanese bombed Chittagong and Calcutta, and thousands were kicked off their land to make room for makeshift airstrips and army bases. Then, just to make sure everyone else was miserable, a cyclone struck and destroyed the rice crop. Over 3 million would die of the famine that followed. Though victorious, Britain was ruined by the war, and independence came to India in 1947. Since the Hindus and Muslims could not get along, a separate country for Muslims was carved out of India called Pakistan. Though on the other side of the country, Muslim East Bengal also became part of Pakistan. Since it was east of Pakistan, it was called East Pakistan. But the problems were far from over. For one thing, the elites of Big Pakistan considered the Bengalis to be culturally inferior and wanted Urdu to be the only official language, even though only 3% spoke it, as opposed to 56% speaking Bengali. As Big Pakistan's bullying persisted, Bengalis began seeing it like the Mughal Empire again, North Indians bossing Bengalis about. So resistance sprang up, with demands for more autonomy. By 1971, it seemed as though Bengali East Pakistan would get its freedom, and Big Pakistan lunged in to stop it. On the 25th of March, Pakistan began Operation Searchlight to squash Bengali nationalism for good. Tanks and troops swept into the capital Dhaka and beat the Bengali police and paramilitary. Flamethrowers burned the slums and they shot down whoever fled. They attacked the university and nationalist leader Sheikh Mujibur Rahman was arrested. Violence engulfed the whole country, with executions and mass murder everywhere. But Bengalis were victorious in Chittagong, where they cried out for Bengalis everywhere to resist the invaders. The people fought back and the war began. Pakistan's plan for a quick solution failed, and after it bombed India, India sided with the Bengalis, and Pakistan surrendered 2 weeks later. East Pakistan became Bangladesh, a sovereign country. The beloved Rahman became prime minister, but he proved to be a dictator, putting the state in control of businesses and industries. Inflation and famine followed, and he was assassinated. Under Zia-Rahman, the country rebuilt and improved. Then he was assassinated. Things did not get much better under this guy, and he resigned, followed by Khaled Zia, who also resigned, followed by Sheikh Hasina, who returned in 2009 and has been prime minister since then. Bangladesh's economy has been growing very rapidly, and there's been a lot of improvements made, but problems such as corruption and poverty and poor healthcare remain. So good luck to Bangladesh as you progress through this century, but that's it from me for now. Bye-bye.